We welcome you this morning as we gather for worship. We are pleased that you can be present with us. We'll have the opportunity to sing our praises to God, to offer him our prayers, to be fed and nourished by his word and his meal. And we invite you to join us for a time of fellowship after worship. We gather back in the fellowship hall, have a cup of coffee and maybe another snack as we visit and share together and get to know each other a little bit better. I remind you that the school tool project is underway. The collection box is in the narthex area, and the list of items we're seeking are in the mini news. We'd like to complete that collection by the end of this month so that early in August we can distribute that to the students going back to school. And if you'd like to donate money instead of purchasing things, Brenda will go shopping for you and fill in things that we need to make the backpacks even. So that's a possibility as well. We have also set the date for the church picnic. It's going to be on Sunday, August the 13th. The 8 o'clock worship service will be here at church, but this 10:30 service is going to be at the Williams Township Park over in Auburn. And after that service, we'll have our picnic. The congregation will provide the meat, and everybody else is asked to bring a dish to pass. So come and spend a wonderful time of fellowship with the congregation and save that date for the 13th of August. This morning, we're celebrating the sixth Sunday after Pentecost. In our gospel reading, Jesus invites us to be yoked to him and also promises that he will give rest to all of us who were burdened and carrying heavy loads. At the early service this morning, we were privileged to have Nora Ritter play the piano by herself and then with Norma. They took off to go camping, so she's not here this service, but I suggested that it would be nice if Norma shared her talents with us. We are thankful for her music every Sunday. We are thankful for her leadership with our choir and throughout the summer. She's the one who arranges the special music we have each week. And this morning at the time of the special music, she is going to play for us. And so we thank her for that. We'll finish our preparation for worship by turning to the order for confession and forgiveness. If you are able, I'd invite you to please rise. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who greets us in this and every season, whose word never fails, whose promise is true. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of our neighbors. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned. We have hurt our community. We have squandered your blessings. We have hoarded your bounty. In the name of Jesus, forgive us and grant us your mercy. Righteous God, we confess that we have sinned. We have failed to be honest. We have lacked the courage to speak. We have spoken falsely. In the name of Jesus, forgive us and grant us your mercy. God is a cup of cold water when we thirst. God offers boundless grace when we fail. Claim the gift of God's mercy. You are freed and forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Oh.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. You are great, O God, and greatly to be praised. You have made us for yourself, and our hearts are restless until they rest in you. Grant that we may believe in you, call upon you, know you, and serve you. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. I need to share a few thoughts with you this morning. Many of you know that right now there are many more churches who are looking for pastors than there are pastors that are available. And that is something that your call committee is learning to deal with. But it's also the case that there are very few pastors available to cover the many churches who are without pastors, either because they are between pastors or we have about four pastors who are out in the Synod because of serious illness, and we have some congregations that are just too small to have a regular full-time pastor. And so the bishop has made a request of me and of this congregation. There are two congregations in the North Country, Spruce Lutheran Church, which is a suburb of Alpena, and Barton City Lutheran Church, that are right now without pastors, and they are having lay-led services each week, which means that they are not able to share Holy Communion. And there are simply no supply pastors available anywhere in the North Country, except I live in West Branch. So the bishop has asked that once a month that I would go up to Spruce and to Barton City and lead their worship service so that once a month they would be able to celebrate Holy Communion. And they made that request of myself and the congregation, and the congregation agreed, and it's going to start next Sunday on the third Sunday of the month. So one Sunday each month, I'm going to be up north and will not be here. Now for the Sundays I'm gone, from August through December, the bishop has recruited a pastor, an ordained person, who will be here. And so the congregation will be able to have communion that week. They had somebody lined up for next Sunday, but that person is not able to do it now. And so next Sunday will be a completely lay-led service here at Messiah. And that means that one Sunday you will not be able to have Holy Communion. I will be here on Thursday evening, and I will be doing the Thursday night service, and so there will be communion there. So if you would like to receive communion next week, you could join us on Thursday night. But I have another request. I am looking for two individuals who might be willing to share about a 5-minute temple talk on the topic of what my relationship with Jesus Christ means in my daily life Monday through Saturday. Or what difference does it make that Jesus is my Lord and Savior in everything that I do between Sunday morning church services? I'm praying that you might listen carefully this morning and see if the Holy Spirit is calling you to be one of two people who would each do about a 5-minute temple talk on that topic next week. And that would take place of the formal sermon. It's just one week that you will not have a pastor here to preach, and one week that you won't be able to share the Lord's Supper. But on the third week of the month, starting next week, I will not be here, and there will be other leadership. So I ask you to prayerfully consider that, and I'm hoping that a couple of people will let me know after the service today that that is something that you think you would be willing to do. So thank you so much for your understanding. The bishop appreciates the congregation's willingness to share me. There are some retired pastors he can get to come here. He can't get people who live in this neck of the woods to drive to Alpena. So that's basically what's going on. Thank you so much, and Gary is going to share our scripture readings.
A reading from Zechariah. Rejoice greatly, O daughter Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter Jerusalem. Lo, your king comes to you. Triumphant and victorious is he, humble and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. He will cut off the chariot from Ephraim and the war horse from Jerusalem, and the battle bow shall be cut off, and he shall command peace to the nations. His dominion shall be from sea to sea, and from the river to the ends of the earth. As for you also, because of the blood of my covenant with you, I will set your prisoners free from the waterless pit. Return to your stronghold, O prisoners of hope. Today I declare that I will restore to you double. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Our solemnity this morning, portions of Psalm 145, we will read responsively. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. Lord, you are good to all, and your compassion is over all your works. All your works shall praise you, O Lord, and your faithful ones shall bless you. They shall tell of the glory of your kingdom and speak of your power, that all peoples may know of your power and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom. Your dominion endures throughout all ages. You, Lord, are faithful in all your words and loving in all your works. The Lord upholds all those who fall and lifts up those who are bowed down.
A reading from Romans. I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. Now, if I do what I do not want, I agree that the law is good. But in fact, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells within me, that is, my flesh. I can will what is right, but I cannot do it. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I do. Now, if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. So I find it to be a law that when I want to do what is good, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my inmost self, but I see in my members another law at war with the law of my mind, making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will rescue me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 11th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus spoke to the crowd, saying, "To what will I compare this generation? It is like children sitting in the marketplaces and calling to one another. We played the flute for you, and you did not dance. We wailed, and you did not mourn. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, he has a demon. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, look, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Yet wisdom is vindicated by her deeds." At that time Jesus said, "I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent and have revealed them to infants. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you that are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and our Lord and our Savior, Jesus the Christ. I was privileged to have a grandmother living in my house with my parents and my siblings all of my preschool years and elementary and junior high school. Nana had fallen and broken a hip, and even though she had surgery, it never healed properly, and so we moved her into a bedroom in our home on the first floor, and she was confined to a wheelchair and bed, but we loved having her stay with us, and she had a crystal clear mind until the very end. But she was also very exacting about things, and so as she got closer to her health deteriorating further, she made all sorts of plans for her funeral. And there was one thing she was very adamant about. She said, "Don't you dare allow them to sing Amazing Grace. Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me." She said, "No one's going to call me a wretch even after I'm dead." I was reminded of that story this week because St. Paul, in his letter to the church at Rome that Gary read just a few moments ago, called himself wretched, wretched man that I am. And Paul would claim that every one of us in this room this morning is wretched as well. The problem is that we all deal with sin. And I think that passage that Gary read is one of the clearest definitions in the scriptures of what sin is all about. It's a hard passage to read. But Paul says, "I know what I want to do, and I can't do it. And I know what I don't want to do, and that's the very thing I end up doing." And he says this several times, and I like to say that what he's suggesting is that we are addicted to sin. And I think human beings are just as addicted to sin as any alcoholic has ever been addicted to alcohol, or that I personally am addicted to sugar. We just can't stop sinning. We don't do what we want to do. We do all sorts of things we know that we should not do. We're trapped. We can't get out of that predicament. As one of our confessions says, we are by nature sinful and unclean. It really goes against our human nature to live according to God's way, because God's way says that we should put others first before ourselves. God's way says that we should love our neighbors always, no matter what the situation is. And that's just unrealistic for those of us who are mere humans. We are caught up in sin. We are addicted to it. We are trapped by it. And so Paul often talks about baptism, because in baptism, that is where we are first forgiven of our sins. We are washed clean in the waters of baptism. We are called by name. God pours out his Holy Spirit upon us, declares that he adopts us into his family. The problem is, though, that we still continue to sin. Yes, baptism washes away what the theologians call original sin, the sin that we were born into because we are human. But even though we are baptized, we continue to sin. We don't stop sinning. That's why every Sunday morning, before we sing the first hymn, we have that little order called the Confession and Forgiveness, where we admit to God and each other that we are sinful and we ask God for forgiveness. Now, I often wonder how our service would be radically different if after we shared that prayer of confession, we had to sit still in silence for 5 minutes while God decided whether or not he was going to forgive us this week. But fortunately, we don't have to worry about that. We know before we pray the prayer and while we're praying the prayer that as soon as we're finished, the pastor is going to speak for God and announce the gift of forgiveness. Because that's because in the sacrament of baptism, not only are we forgiven of original sin and the sin that we have that day, but we are given a promise that any day for the rest of our lives, we can ask God for forgiveness and we can be assured of the answer that God will forgive us. That there'll never be one sin too many, there'll never be one sin too great, too big, that God will not forgive. But even though we are baptized, we live in this trap of sin. So I don't think we have to worry about any Sunday coming up in the next few months when I can get up and say, well, folks, we don't have to do the order of confession and forgiveness this morning because nobody sinned since last Sunday. I don't think that's going to happen. We are trapped by our sins. Only the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ can free us from that trap. But then if we turn to our gospel reading for this morning, we hear some really good words of good news. Now, Jesus is teaching his disciples and his followers, and in that gospel reading for this morning, he really gives three distinct different teachings that really don't have a lot to do with one another. But I want to concentrate on that short teaching at the end, where Jesus invites us to come to him if we are weary and we are carrying heavy burdens. Jesus knew and understood that human life is not all that easy. We struggle with problems in our families. We struggle with problems at work and in our careers. We struggle with the economy and our own bank accounts. We struggle with climate change and what it's doing to our weather. We struggle with warfare and divided politics. It can get very depressing just to watch the evening news, to say nothing of struggling with this constant battle of sin that we're never going to be able to handle on our own. Jesus knows that human life can be tiring and that we can be weary. But he invites us to come to him, and he promises us that he will give us rest. And then he gives us a key as to how life can be easier for us. He says that we should take his yoke upon us. Now, most of us aren't involved in agriculture today, and since all the machinery that farmers use have been invented, we're probably not all that familiar with the yoke. But the yoke was a large wooden frame that connected two animals together, a structure that had two holes for the heads, and it kept the farm animals working in unison. The people had figured out that two oxen could haul a cart and do it faster and more efficiently than just one ox by itself, but they had also figured out that two oxen pulling the same cart can do it more efficiently if they are yoked together so that they are forced to be in sync, going in the same direction at the same speed. Jesus is suggesting that we want to be yoked with him, that as we make our way through this life, which can be filled with ups and downs and twists and turns and tragedies and difficulties, Jesus, who promises he is the way, the truth, and the life, invites us to be yoked to him so that we're walking side by side with him and he can guide us through the way and lead us in the way we should go. Now, that's not going to totally stop us from sinning. Our addiction is still strong. But perhaps that will allow us to more often do those things we want to do and not do those things we don't want to do. That might help us to sin less and to be faithful more often because we go in sync with our Lord and Savior. Now, the church has appreciated this symbol of the yoke. I'm a very large person and I sweat. And so I've decided that during the summer months, I'm not going to get dressed up in my liturgical clothes. But we've often talked about how the alb that a pastor wears is a reminder of baptism. We put on the white garment, reminding us that we have been washed clean and that we have been forgiven in baptism. And it's somewhat like the garments that were worn in biblical times as well. But the other thing that we do is that the ordained pastor wears a stole. And some of us were at Vicar Tina's ordination just a few weeks ago, and a very important part of the ordination service is when the bishop places the stole on a newly ordained pastor for the first time. It is a sign or a symbol that that person is ordained. But the reason we use this particular symbol is it reminds us of the yoke. It reminds us that as pastors, we are yoked to Jesus and that we are given the responsibility of representing Jesus. When I preach the sermon, hopefully it's not all my thoughts and words, but it is God's word, the word of the risen Christ, that the Holy Spirit allows me to speak. And when I stand behind this table and officiate at this meal, this is Christ's meal. And I'm representing Christ, who was the host of that table, who has invited all of us to come. And Christ is also the meal at this table. It is his body and his blood. And the fact that the ordained pastor wears the stole reminds us that as pastors, we are yoked to Christ. We are officiating at his table, preaching his word, sharing his meal. And the stole reminds us that we are dependent on the Holy Spirit to do not just what we as individuals want to do, but what God wants us to do and calls us to do as pastors. And this morning in the gospel reading, Jesus is inviting all of you as well to come to him and to be yoked to him. So the bad news this morning is that we're going to continue to sin, you and I and everybody else. And next Sunday morning, you're going to have to do the order of confession and forgiveness all over again. But the good news is, as we go through this life that can be difficult and challenging, we don't have to go alone. The risen Christ calls us to come to him and invites us to be yoked to him, that he might guide us and lead us along the way, so that hopefully we live more in ways pleasing to him and less in the ways of our addictive sin. That's truly good news. Amen.
Thank you.
With the whole church, we confess our common faith, sharing together the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Confident that God receives our joys and concerns, let us offer our prayers for the church, those in need, and all of creation. God of the covenant, you call ministers to proclaim your gospel of grace throughout the world. Inspire pastors, deacons, church musicians, and all ministers of your word, especially Pastor Sherston Sullivan at Trinity in Battle Creek, Reverend Richard Steve at Trinity in Frankfort, and Pastor Dan Stonebeck as he guides us through our transition here at Messiah. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of all creation, you reveal your goodness through all you have made. Rivers and seas, plants and animals, and endangered species. Prosper the work of conservation organizations, botanical gardens, zoos, and wildlife sanctuaries. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of the nations, you desire that all the peoples of the world live in peace. Guide government leaders at all levels, national, state, and local, to work for justice, mercy, and reconciliation. Help us to put aside the angry word, the clenching fist, the wish and will to hurt. Teach us the way in which love is best served. We pray that we will treat our neighbors, including our enemies, with a kindness and respect that delight you. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of compassion, you bring healing to those who are sick, consolation to those who are grieving, and well-being to those who are distraught. Send skilled caregivers to all in need. We remember Karen Anderson, our healthcare professional in Santiago, Chile, and make your presence known among all who suffer. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of rejoicing, you have brought us together this day to worship around word and sacrament. We pray for our friends at Messiah, Doug and Cindy Preem, Jim Princeau, Beth, Logan, and Lauren Rabideau, Cindy Rabideau, Matthew, Karen, Bree, and Robert Rapley, and Jessica Reed. Encourage our children in their learning and growing, and watch over those who are absent today. Lead us all to places of renewal and refreshment. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of all faithfulness, through the witness of the faithful departed, you reveal love in action. Embolden us by their example to build up the beloved community in all the contexts we encounter. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great. Into your hands, gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always. Peace be with you. Peace be with you.
God of field and forest, sea and sky. You are the giver of all good things. Sustain us with these gifts of your creation and multiply your graciousness in us, that the world may be fed with your love, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed it is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest. Holy God, mighty Lord, gracious Father, endless is your mercy and eternal your reign. You have filled all creation with light and life. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. We praise you for the grace shown to your people in every age, the promise to Israel, the rescue from Egypt, the gift of the promised land, the words of the prophets, and at this end of all the ages, the gift of your Son, who proclaimed the good news in word and deed and was obedient to your will, even to giving his life. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Christ has risen.
Therefore, O God, with this bread and cup we remember the life our Lord offered for us, and believing the witness of his resurrection, we await his coming in power to share with us the great and promised feast. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. So now we pray your Holy Spirit, that we who share in Christ's body and blood may live to the praise of your glory, and receive our inheritance with all your saints in light. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit. Join our prayers to those of your servants of every time and every place, and unite them with the ceaseless petitions of our great high priest, until he comes as victorious Lord of all. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. All people were called to Christ's table. Come, eat what is good.
Jesus.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
We thank you, generous God, for the refreshment we have received at your banquet table. Send us now to spread your generosity into all the world through the one who is our dearest treasure, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. The God who calls across the cosmos and speaks in the smallest seed, bless, keep, and sustain you, now and to the end of the age. Amen.